So I was going to talk about quadratic Poisson structures, but I mean, kind of, I didn't put the preprint yet on the archive. It was delayed, and therefore I changed the title to something simpler. So this is like what I will be talking about is a simpler version of that more complicated story about quadratic Poisson structures. So the title is on the classification of concierge familiarity maps, but I should kind of make a disclaimer what we do classify. I mean, concierge made a universal construction, universal in the sense, I mean, which it applies to any Poisson structure. It does not see details of any particular Poisson structure. So universal one. Therefore, we classify universal familiarity maps. I will make a precise definition. So probably it will be half of my lecture to make this word universal precise. And then we shall see kind of a combinatorial gadget. Sorry?
Can you make it a bit bigger? This.
Yeah, sure. I will now turn off camera and make it share the screen. Is it better?
No, it's the same, but just maybe go in the first half, just make it bigger. Is it possible or?
Wait a minute, share. Oh, it worked. Does it work?
Hello, second. Oh, no, we have.
I don't know why.
Hello, Sergey. Can you turn on screen share again? You can turn on your camera and screen share at the same time.
I see. Okay. Sorry. I see. Okay. I did it. Okay. And now sharing. Somehow I'm denied access. I'm sorry, let me log off and log in again. Is it okay? Sorry, I apologize. Somehow sharing stopped working. It worked a few minutes ago. Okay, therefore I will leave and come back. Okay, I hope you can now see the screen, right?
This is much better, thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, right, classification of concierge familiarity maps. So we classify universal concierge familiarity maps, which in fact do not see any particularities of your concrete Poisson structure. Therefore, essentially, in the first half of my talk, I would just put to define this word universal, and we shall arrive at some kind of purely combinatorial problem of graph complexes. And then I explain briefly how we compute cohomology and answer this question. In fact, this classification was done before by Vasily Dalgushev, but the point of this talk and the paper, which is joint with Asar Anderson, is to give a very, very simple proof of everything. So, okay, the proofs are just a couple of pages. Most of the kind of time as usual is to explain notation. Therefore, particular Poisson structures are not visible in this approach, which is bad, right? This is why I also thought about quadratic Poisson structures. What happens with classification of kind of a concierge familiarity maps applied to quadratic Poisson structures. These are kind of graded familiarity maps. You know, kind of if we talk about formal functions, this is just symmetric tensor power. There is some kind of this button, it's a new grading. If we talk about concierge familiarity maps, which respect these gradings, kind of, you know, polynomial structure of your functions. Now your function is a polynomial, and you want in some sense this polynomial structure be preserved, then you come to this problem of concierge familiarity map for quadratic Poisson structures. We know that kind of linear Poisson structures are algebras, and we know, I mean, their quantization is unique. So the classification set is just one point. What about quadratic ones? It's a very interesting question, and in fact, much more difficult than the ones I discussed today, kind of generic Poisson structure where everything is allowed. No restrictions of being quadratic. This problem was also solved. The answer is similar to this one, but today I just talk about generic Poisson structures. Let me kind of specify the scene. So kind of some notation. So formal, we work with formal Poisson structures or kind of Poisson structures on the vector space. Right, then kind of algebra of formal smooth functions becomes either the usual, you can omit completed. It's completed or not completed, it's the same. Yeah, so this is what we understand by smooth functions. This is graded commutative algebra. We want to deform this graded commutative product using Poisson vector fields on V. Right, what is a tangent smooth vector fields? Those are just derivations of this algebra, right? It's a collection there. I mean, it's a free algebra, therefore any derivation is given by its values and generators. It's a collection of such linear maps, which can be chosen arbitrarily. What are polyvector fields? Well, I mean, again, it's a collection now of linear maps like this, with shifted degree. The Poisson structure, yeah, you see there is a VV dual. This pairing induces degree minus one Lie bracket on this thing, which is the standard Skouten Lie bracket of polyvector fields. And in this approach, kind of on the vector space, when we allow just general linear transformations, our Poisson structure decomposes into monomials. It's a graded Poisson structure, so maybe it's not a bivector field in general. It could be whatever. Into the monomials. Right. This is the first elementary observation, which has very deep consequences for us. Let us now interpret this every monomial in our Poisson structure as equivalent morphism from something very simple. This is a one-dimensional module of these permutation groups. One-dimensional module. This is a vector space where, I mean, a concrete Poisson structure lives. So essentially, every monomial is equivalent morphism from very something very simple to something which can be, I mean, huge, depending on the particular V. We want to forget about particular V. So essentially, this is the guy we shall work with. First step. It's a one-dimensional, there is a unique basis element up to rescaling. Let me denote it in such a way. As a corolla, it's a kind of graph with n input legs. You should assume there is a flow, kind of there are arrows. N inputs, if you look at this, n input, m outputs. I don't write arrows, it's a kind of a tradition in the theory of props. You assume a flow, either from bottom to the top or from top to the bottom, depending on your taste. In my case, always from bottom to the top. So N inputs, M outputs, and they are skew symmetries. It's a kind of notation for this element. Why such a notation? It has a meaning. Look, what happens? I mean, look at the right-hand side. I mean, such linear maps take values in the same vector space. Therefore, we can compose them. Even partially composing. We can pick up one of the outputs, say for one map PMN, and insert it into another map, say PPQ, whatever. They can be composed. Usual substitution of kind of maps. How it will look like in terms of these generators? Well, in fact, I mean, given such a collection of maps, it makes sense now create more complicated graphs out of this generator for this equivalent mode, for this module. Right, you know, if you know the values of your map on these two generators, you know what happens, it makes sense. You can now really, you can now create all possible graphs out of these corollas, just on the sheet of paper, whatever you want, by gluing out legs of such a corolla to in legs in all possible ways, with genus, trees, whatever you want, prefer. and you always have a well-defined map on the right-hand side for some MN. Yeah, this is will be usual composition. Well, now we can really forget about OV. We can forget about Poisson structure and work with this substitution, with these graphs. Let me warn you, let me give you a warning. For example, this is a well-defined now graph. It can be mapped. Once our maps PMN fixed, it can be, we can map it to concrete map here, well-defined. But I can kind of take a trace. This is an output, this is input. I can create a more complicated graph, which will now have kind of a wheel, a directed path of edges, which is closed. So here we don't have such paths. Flow goes up. You know, if there is no arrow in an edge, it goes from bottom to the top. Here it goes in the reverse direction, and you can see, well, kind of we can now see the difference, combinatorial difference between Poisson structures in infinite dimensions and on finite dimensional vector spaces. So this operation will be defined on any Poisson structure, whatever V is, infinite or finite dimensional. But this, sorry, this is my parrot. I decided to give it up. But look at this one. In fact, if V is infinite dimensional, this has no sense. It will diverge. Therefore, we must be. Therefore, already at this level, we see a difference between Poisson structures in infinite dimensions and finite ones. There is a deep combinatorial difference. Oriented graphs, no wheels, and finite, only wheels. And we know concierge familiarity maps works only for finite dimensional Poisson structures. You cannot use these ones. Right. Therefore, we have to be careful. We have to distinguish kind of when we start building graphs from generators of this simple S-module, we have to be careful. Do we allow wheels or we do not? So if we do not allow wheels, I just write it holip 1.0. For, not 1.0 will be explained later. If I allow wheels, I will have this error. Right. So this is a vector space built from all corollas like this, in all possible ways by gluing out and in legs. What about Lie bracket? It's a nice thing. I mean, Lie bracket is encoded, I mean, scouting Lie bracket on polyvector fields is encoded into a differential. Both of these spaces, oriented or with wheels, can be made into a complex. And you see here already scouting bracket. Scouting bracket, what is it? It's essentially this pairing V in V dual. V dual in, V out, it's glue in one leg. And in fact, this is a differential delta squared. So it's a complex. It's a complex. So why not 1.0? You can simply take slightly general situation. You can work with corollas like this, with different degree, with they can be, so if this one are kind of symmetric in the outputs, Q symmetric in inputs, here it can be whatever, it depends on these parameters C and D. Why is it important? Well, in fact, if you consider truncated versions for this guy, for C1, D1, you essentially come to the theory of Lie algebras, homotopy theory of Lie algebras. So I'm talking today about Poisson structures. But essentially, the same idea, whatever it talks, it makes sense for any Lie algebra. So if you like, I mean, Poisson structure is a homotopy 1.0 by algebra. Well, not homotopy, no, these complexes are acyclic. Yes, they are acyclic. But they are not cofibrant. Therefore, acyclicity does not mean you can replace such complex by its cohomology. It's not cofibrant. Let me now cite a result which motivated the present work. It's a result obtained jointly with Thomas Volwacha. We started this truncated complex when we allow monomials of 3 and high only, it's a minimum resolution. It has of Lie algebras. And we computed cohomology of the derivation complex of this guy. And found what? Found Kontsevich graph complex. Well, it's a bit slightly different from Kontsevich. So GCD, this is classical Kontsevich graph complex. It's spanned by connected graphs. Here, as you see, symmetric tensor power means the graphs can be disconnected. And then we added some element K, which is what is the job? It's a kind of a artificial element, but very natural. It's kind of, it controls a rescaling structure here. And the point is the Lie bracket of element here with elements here is highly non-trivial, right? So elements here look like this, linear combinations of graphs with no directions. In fact, this stands for some element of the GRT group. And as you see, the case C1D1, not the one which works for important for Poisson structures, the one which is important for Lie bi-algebras. In the non-oriented, non-willed case, we get GRT. This is a result of Thomas Wilbacher of 2010. It's a great paper, a great result. Right. And please notice what happened. I mean, if you compare to original paper, there is no one. It's full GRT. There is no one. It's not GRT1. It's not a kernel of full GRT. This is what this key takes care about. Right. We kind of amazing fact that in the case of Lie bi-algebra, the Grothendieck-Müller group acts on the probe. We forgot Lie bi-algebras. We replace them by these kind of gadgets. And this is where GRT acts. Right, this was the motivation. So the question was, we proved this result for families of Lie-Holib CD, for all CD. And the question is, what about Poisson structures? But then for Poisson, we would be interested in the willed version, in the version which has closed path of directed edges, traces. Out of Poisson structures, we can consider operations which take traces of this, the derivatives or whatever. And you know, the approach which was developed in that paper does not work here immediately. And let me tell you the following. If you just take the willed version of Holib 1-1, the story becomes very difficult. I think we understand that now by now. Very difficult. But this is a truncated version. But non-truncated version, full one, which I studied in this paper, in this talk, it's much easier. So essentially, the version I'm telling today is very easy. You know, kind of a, essentially, it was clear long ago, but simply we have written down everything. Right, why it's important to compute derivation complex of this gadget, which controls kind of universal Poisson structures, universal homotopy Lie bi-algebra structures. Because you can apply, I mean, later we applied with Thomas, this paper should appear this year in Composition. We could have classified all deformation quantizations of possibly finite or infinite dimensional Lie bi-algebras. And proved this is the set of Drinsfeld associators. Not surprising, but I mean, I think this is the first rigorous. I mean, we all expected this result, but it's proven. And now this more complicated version I'm not talking about today, but let me mention what happens if we just take care about deformation quantizations of only finite dimensional Lie bi-algebra. So kind of we now allow to use in the construction of kind of a quantization graphs with wheels. Then the story becomes radically different. And I just simply state the claim. For me, it's a theorem, but I didn't post it. Therefore, at this moment, it's a claim. In fact, the set of such quantizations is a product. There are two associators. Of course, you can choose diagonal, and then you recover old story. But the full classification in the finite dimensional case, for the willed version, therefore, it's two associators, or is the same one associator, one element of GRT. What it means, essentially, let me explain you. It's not published, but it's elementary. I mean, when you kind of consider universal quantization of infinite dimensional Lie algebras, you can prove the, you know, Lie algebras. You consider dualization functor, your Lie algebra becomes Co-Lie, your Co-Lie becomes Lie, and the same on the right-hand side with Bi algebra. Product becomes co-product, and so one can prove that an infinite dimensional case, whatever quantization you have, up to gauge equivalence, it is equivalent to the one which commutes with kind of this dualization. You swap Lie and Co-Lie, and then your S and co-S multiple structures also swapped automatically. This is why you need two, one just as associator. It's a theorem, you know, it's who should be written down, it's kind of a laziness. It follows, it's a non-trivial result, it follows from some work of Marko Zivkovic, who related some oriented and oriented and wheeled graph complexes. He gave an explicit construction, and in some of his preliminary steps implies this particular claim. That, I mean, whatever universal quantization in infinite dimensions you have, it's also kind of a symmetric when you change flow. If you like what you do, you kind of turn upside down this corolla. I mean, it's the same happens with the answer. It's also turned upside down. But in the case of finite, that's not true. So essentially what it means, kind of a one associator takes care about Lie, another about Co-Lie. And you know, amazingly, they all can be made compatible such that all the conditions are satisfied. So this is the claim. But I mean, okay. I didn't show yet the paper. I hope it will be posted soon. But therefore, let me back. Go. It's a difficult story. It's really difficult, much more complicated than what I'm talking about today. Let me come back to a more simple version. You know, truncated version is difficult. But full version, where I allow everything, you know, even constants. This, we allow generators, this MN corollas for M0, N0, no restriction M plus N greater than 3. We proved with Asar Anderson, it's a preprint, that again, we recover concierge graph complex. And now, look, GRT appears not in 1-1. It appears precisely for the full version which controls Poisson structures. Let me tell you, the proof is easy. The proof is elementary. It's, you know, if you read my paper with Thomas, it's kind of even easier than the story developed there. So it's not a big deal. It's not a big deal to prove this theorem at all. By the way, what happens, therefore, kind of on finite dimensional Poisson structures, GRT acts. Again, we kind of knew it from various sources. This is simply a new way to see this result. Again, it's proof is easy, and the result itself is kind of quite evident. Simply, it was formulated in different ways. But by contrast, if you don't allow will, there is nothing kind of, it's rigid. So infinite dimensional Poisson structures have no non-trivial automorphisms up to homotopy. They're all homotopy trivial. While in finite dimensional, that's not true, GRT acts. And now we come to the second and most important part of the story, deformation quantization. Again, we talk about universal ones, which we are able to encode into kind of combinatorial gadgets, like shown here. Essentially, computations, you make such graphs into complex by splitting vertex in two and distributing all edges between these two new vertices in a certain way. And so it's a purely combinatorial problem. And here again, we have to kind of to think a little how to understand Kantsevich universal formality map as a kind of combinatorial thing. Now first, what Kantsevich formality map is doing for graded Poisson structures? It creates, in general, curved homotopy associative algebras. There is an operat which controls them. It's kind of a, now again, flow goes from bottom to the up, and input N0 is allowed, and one output. And this is a differential, as usual. So if all car, if all right, I mean, you can see associativity conditions here when applied to N3. Well, and you assume other generators for N0 and N1 disappear. Well, Maxim Kantseevich map, what is it doing? Take any Poisson structure, input for his formula, output, homotopy curved as infinity structure on this guy. And therefore, but in our combinatorial approach, the left-hand side, this is something which leaves by this prop we just talked about, which leaves in V, but the right-hand side is in fact something which leaves in the symmetric tensor algebra, not V. Therefore, kind of we cannot think we can compare, relate, the, you know, formality map in the universal meaning should kind of relate these two things. But as you see, you have to do something to whole leap to just theoretically related to curved as infinity algebras. And what to do is, again, it's universal construction, which is found by Thomas Eppelbach and myself in our paper on ribbon graphs. We've constructed a kind of universal functor, exact functor, polydifferential functor, which is doing what? Take any prop, you construct an operator with a property. If your input prop is represented in some vector space V, then what you get as a result is represented in the symmetric tensor algebra. Let me kind of briefly explain what happens when we apply this functor to this Poisson structures, the prop which controls Poisson structures, combinatoric of Poisson structures. It's very simple. So a generic element of whole heap looks like this. Remember, we just glue our corollas along legs. And they're kind of a symmetrized, they're labeled. This is some element from, say, V tensor power 6 to V tensor power 2. What we do, we kind of, you know, it could be very complicated graphs. We divide all inputs into blocks, which we label and assign labels and big circles. And they kind of are, each block is glued. So each block is glued. Say this, I have chosen 1 and 4 glued to 1. Then I created what? I took what? I took 2 and 5 glued to this vertex. And then to 3 I glued, okay. You see, and then I have written some empty vertex as well. I can do it. All out legs, they are just attached to one vertex. This, what this means, we symmetrize leg. Remember, in the corolla, this is Q-symmetrized. This is Q-symmetrized. But we can symmetrize over 1, 4. And 2, 5, and this is how we reflect it here. Essentially, gluing to one leg means we symmetrized over the corresponding leg, symmetrized here. Therefore, I cannot glue 1, 2 to one leg because symmetrization will kill such things. You know, I have to use different vertices. So this is what this function is doing. So it's again, it's a very explicit. This complex which we get is very, very explicit. You just take such corollas, you divide in blocks, and associate in all possible ways, you get elements of this operator. Operator composition, just what you do, you take such graph and substitute, say, into 3 of a similar graph and distribute edges in all possible ways. But now, okay, the result is, now we can understand Kantseevich formality map as a morphism of DG operators. Again, now we forget about any vector space, about any manifold, about whatever, because in Kantseevich formula is universal. We shouldn't really talk about concrete Poisson structures. So this is a purely combinatorial thinking for Kantseevich formality maps. And this is what is it doing. It's a morphism of DG props, but of course, non-triviality conditions. It could be zero. We don't allow zero. We allow non-triviality condition. It's about what happens kind of with linear terms. It's a Poisson structure. Okay, it's a kind of, a, your deformation should start with your Poisson structure. So this is the condition. Now we have this map, okay, but this is good for us because we can now apply our construction. Okay, there are several, on operas, there are several papers how to do it. On properas, it's done by Bruno Valette and myself. You can cook out of these two gadgets, again, a deformation complex, which now controls deformation theory of any particular map F. In general, it controls deformation theory of everything, but we then want to keep these boundary conditions. They will simplify. They are important because this is what will make some spectral sequence degenerate and makes complete computation really elementary. Really elementary. Okay. Its element can be described explicitly. How they look like. Essentially, they would look like these, with different gradients and kind of a differential which can split white vertices in two new. Two new are these ones, kind of when you substitute such a graph into, say, vertex 3, you create two new vertices. So, right. Again, it's very explicit. And now the second result, we computed it. We computed its cohomology. I stated the result for C0D1. We know it in general. So essentially, again, the Kontsevich graph complex is here. Is here. And again, let me tell you, the proof is amazingly elementary. It's just, it's what is it is just spectral sequence, and then on the first page you see essentially the permutahedral cell complex. It's a polytope, I mean, very famous polytopes. They are contractible, and therefore you know the answer. I mean, this is it. On the next page, essentially, you get this guy. So the proof is just half a page. So essentially, in this way, we get a very short proof of we have at least the first cohomology, right? It computes all infinitesimal deformations of the universal Kontsevich fermionative maps. Again, this is H0 of the Kontsevich graph complex. Thanks to Thomas Wilbacher, we know this is GRT. This is GRT. And essentially, this is a short proof of the beautiful, remarkable theorem by Vasily Dolgushov, who got this result in a very different way. It's a big paper, but I mean, a very nice paper, but we have a short one. That's a short proof. And let me say the following, kind of you might ask questions maybe at this stage, kind of here I computed on infinitesimal deformations, right? But to claim this theorem, I should kind of be sure that any such deformation, infinitesimal, can be exponentiated to a genuine deformation, no obstructions. You know, obstructions would lie in H2. H2 will be H1 of this complex, which is, you know, it's amazing conjecture. It's conjecture is that, in fact, it is zero, but it's very strange zero. I mean, every cycle is a co-boundary only using some Drinfield associator. So this is it's a conjecture. We don't know is it true. But therefore, okay, I don't know is it true that obstructions vanish. But still, I can claim there are no obstructions here. The reason is that kind of there are two Lie brackets here, one in degree zero, one in degree minus one, and we can use degree minus one bracket to exponentiate with no obstructions. Again, kind of we did, yeah, it should be explained. It's not explained in our current version in archive. I'm sorry for this. Kind of it's evident, but it should be written down fully. It's known to specialists that in many stories like this, you can exponentiate. There are no obstructions at all. But it should be skipped in written form. So this is the result. We get a short proof of this result. But again, as I tell you, I mean, now we are talking about classification of in the universal settings applied to generic Poisson structures, generic ones. But it would be interesting kind of to see at least concrete examples for kind of concrete Poisson structures, what we can do. And you know, there is a lack. We don't know much about it. So we know GRT acts on generic Poisson structures, but I mean, to have at least one example when this action is non-trivial on a concrete one is an open problem. The main problem is it's hard to compute cohomology of for concrete Poisson structure. They look like wild complexes, undoable ones. But in any case, it's still a good question, and let us think what we can do going from generic to kind of particular ones, concrete examples. On linear Poisson structures, we know it's dead. Action is trivial. No, I mean, this is next step, quadratic ones. And this is what I was going to talk about, but I didn't post the paper. And I mean, it's a much more difficult story, really, different level of difficulties. But the answer is the same. You know, it's a claim. I have not shown the proof that starting from quadratic, GRT acts. And this gives a hope, probably there is plenty of examples of quadratic Poisson structures. Probably we can then try to put down this classification theorem down to earth, to concrete applications. Right. Essentially, I'm over. I'm sorry. This is it.